Hi, everybody. We're going to go ahead and get started because we have a star-studded event with several of the real luminaries of the work-life field. I'm Liza Mundy. I'm the director of our work-life program here at the New America Foundation, which we're calling Breadwinning and Caregiving, in recognition of the fact that, as Anne-Marie Slaughter has pointed out, everybody now at some point in their life will be a breadwinner. Everybody will be a caregiver at some point and will need caregiving at some point. And what we aim to do with our program is to expand and reframe the conversation around work life to acknowledge that everybody, male or female, is playing these dual roles. We want to expand the conversation around work life to include same-sex households, to include lower income households, to include men for sure. And so we have today, as I said, marquee players in this field. We have our president and CEO, Anne-Marie Slaughter, author of the magazine article that broke the internet on why we can't have it all, at least not all at one time. We have Joan C. Williams, who is distinguished professor and director of the Center for Work-Life Law at the University of California. Her writings, her research in this field has really been seminal for all of us who are writing and thinking about these issues. And we have her daughter, Rachel Dempsey, who is a student at Yale Law School and blogs for the Huffington Post on women's issues. Together, Joan Williams and Rachel Dempsey are the co-authors of a new book called What Works for Women at Work, Four Patterns Working Women Need to Know in Order to Succeed in the Workplace. And with that, I will hand it over to Anne-Marie, who's going to be moderating the event. The event will go until 1:30. The authors have another event this afternoon that they'll have to go to, but they are going to stay around for about, they'll have about 10 minutes to sign books. So as I said, I'll turn it over to them now, and I can't wait to hear what they have to say. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. So this is just a pure pleasure, I have to say, for a number of reasons. So the first is, after my article had, I think what is fair to say, a rather bigger reaction than I expected, I was expecting a little wave and I got a tsunami, I was all of a sudden on media all the time, and the very first person I called was Joan, whom I didn't really know, but I knew that she was the person who I respected the most in women, work, law, feminist studies. I'm an international relations person. I was completely, I had written an article about my experience, and I called Joan and said, what are the basic outlines of the argument that I should be making in terms of thinking about women and work and life? And she talked about the ideal worker, and she talked about the work that her center at Berkeley in San Francisco has done. So that's the first thing, and she was incredibly generous. I remember I called you out of the blue, and you just gave me a lot of help. And the second thing is, and you don't know this, so now I'm writing a book, and I finally sat down and read Unbending Gender cover to cover, and every single page is marked. And I read it, and I thought, I don't know why I'm writing a book, because Joan Williams already wrote the book that I want to write and that many other people want to write. Unbending Gender is just such a powerful, path-breaking analysis of what's really wrong, of the cult of work, of the cult of the ideal worker, of what we think a worker is supposed to do in terms of being on 24/7, of how market work is completely supported by a flow of family work. See, I really have read it cover to cover.
You read the book.
I reread the book. But the idea that, of course, you can't do market work, certainly not the way our society expects you to do market work, unless you're supported by a flow of family work. And what we've got are women trying to do both the market work and the family work. We haven't really changed either the work culture or the true unbending gender, which is unbending gender around men as well as around women. So if you haven't read Unbending Gender, or you haven't read it for a while, I would say go back to do it, because all of us in this field owe Joan, and certainly that book, an enormous debt. And the third reason is because I wrote the foreword to this book, and it's a wonderful book, and we're going to talk about it. And last year, I had the chance, I guess it was last fall, to go and give a talk at Yale Law School and finally to meet Rachel, who I knew only through the pages of this book. But I think there's something very special about the idea that this book, which is a book that really every, as I put in the introduction or in the foreword, every woman who works should read and every man who works with women should read. I mean, it's really aimed at men and women. But what it's very appropriate that it's written by Joan and Rachel, because so many of these issues are being discussed again, in my view, because of the, what you said, the generational divide. The generational, where younger women are seeing these issues differently than certainly my generation, but above all of the generation just 10 years ahead of me, who were the true pioneers. I don't know if you put yourself in that generation or not. I think you're in between. So anyway. So with that as a start, I'm going to just moderate this conversation for about a half hour, and then I'm going to turn it over to all of you, because I know you will all have questions. And I'm going to just start by framing the book for those of you who have not yet read it. It is framed around four basic barriers and problems or challenges that women encounter at work. And I'm going to let both Joan and Rachel talk about them, but I'll just say the first is prove it again. Prove it again. Prove it again that you know you can actually do what you've already demonstrated. The second is the tightrope. The tightrope between being too masculine or too feminine. The third, which we all know about, is the maternal wall. Hitting the wall when you have children. And the fourth is the tug of war. Often the tug of war among women. So that's the overall frame. Let me start out by sort of asking you each to talk about, just to sort of describe some of those. I'm going to start, actually, Joan, and ask you to talk about Prove It Again.
Okay. Well, first of all, Anne-Marie, it's a delight to be here, and I'm really honored by what you say. I'm really touched. Thank you. Prove It Again is the fact that if you think about a brilliant scientist, CEO, you name it, most people will think about a kind of tall white man. And so women don't seem to fit quite as well. And consequently, they often have to provide more evidence of competence than men in order to be seen as equally competent. And that's the first pattern of gender bias. I interviewed for this book 127 highly successful women. There are really two different studies. One was 60 women of color in science, because I really wanted to think about how the experience of gender bias differs by race. And then for about a three-year period, every time I met an extremely savvy woman, I just said, can I have an hour and a quarter of your time? And I met very highly successful women and interviewed them. About two-thirds of them had encountered this Prove It Again bias.
And one of the things you say that I found particularly striking is the, you know, men are promoted on potential and women are promoted on performance. So this idea that, and I've certainly been in these conversations where you're talking about, you know, can she do it? And so often instead of, wow, you know, she's done this and look at the potential, it's, well, let's see. You know, then that's exactly that, prove it again. You know, you've proven it once, but do it again, as opposed to you do it once and you see this. And I just have to say that when I was dean of the Woodrow Wilson School, I was 42 when I became dean. And this, your point about people think of deans as older white men. And so I would constantly be on the airplane or whatever, and somebody would say, what do you do? And I would say, dean. And you could just see this kind of, oh, you're awfully young. And it wasn't that I was awfully young. It was, no. So, I wasn't that young. So Rachel, let me ask you to talk about the tightrope, the sort of too masculine, too feminine, and maybe Joan will want to add in on how you see that.
So the tightrope really stems from the fact that the image of success is masculine. Men are typed as being sort of agentic leaders, whereas women are typed as being communal, community-oriented and kind. And so when people see a woman in a position of leadership, it feels wrong. And the result of that is that women are stereotyped when they act in sort of conventionally masculine ways. They're stereotyped as a word that I can't use here, but they're stereotyped as being abrasive.
It rhymes with witch.
It rhymes with witch. Having rough elbows is something we hear a lot. But when women sort of conform to feminine stereotypes, they're seen as not worthy of being leaders, not appropriate leaders, and are treated accordingly. And so the tightrope is really about walking the balance between those two sets of stereotypes. And we found in speaking with the women that Joan interviewed, we found that in order to be really successful, you had to balance being seen as masculine and being seen as authoritative, and also being seen as sort of as kind and approachable and not facing that backlash that women in power often find they face from the people around them.
So this, again, having worked for Hillary Clinton, right, and, yes. every woman politician says this immediately. You know, they get into the public realm, and immediately, you know, either you're not tough enough to handle national security, or you're just too tough. And I remember talking to Meg Whitman about this after she ran in California. So you have a Republican woman, a Democrat woman. Meg Whitman said to me, you know, I never felt closer to Hillary. Obviously, they're different ideologically, but they had exactly that experience.
Well, and one really interesting factoid that fits in here is that one of the times that Hillary Clinton got the highest approval ratings was
when
she cried, because she was doing what I call gender judo. the gender judo really is that you have to behave in masculine ways in order to be seen as competent. Okay. But you also have to show that you're competent at femininity. And so what many women do, and Hillary Clinton was doing this genuinely, but it happened to work, and the reason it clicked was because everybody knows that Hillary Clinton is competent. But she was taking a feminine stereotype, and so she was getting the best of both worlds. And taking that feminine stereotype that typically holds women back and flipping around its power to propel her forward. That's the judo.
Yeah, I mean, who would have ever thought that the way to advance as a woman would be to cry?
And typically it's not, ladies.
Right. Yeah, right. We're not offering that as career advice. Before I want to talk about the maternal wall, but I can't help but ask, since we're talking about tipping a little too masculine or a little too feminine, you all are dressed a little differently.
Well, this is one of the areas that we had a lot of back and forth, and Rachel will talk about that a little bit.
So I tend towards more too feminine problems, and Joan tends towards more too masculine problems. And obviously, saying feminine and saying masculine is a very gross approximation of sort of what we feel comfortable with, but I'm just going to go with it. So while we were working on the tightrope chapter, we had a lot of back and forth about what strategies worked for what problems. And I'm going to use the example of the posse strategy. So one strategy that we suggest in the tightrope chapter is to find a group of people at work who you feel comfortable with and who you sort of agree to complement each other's successes, draw attention to each other's successes. So that way you're not bragging and you're not doing sort of self-promotion, which is often people often react to that negatively in a woman. And so to me, the posse strategy is great because it means you can get other people to promote you and you don't have to do it yourself, because I think that's really hard and scary. For Joan, the posse strategy is great because you can have self-promotion without the backlash. So for the two of us,
it
fits both of us, but it fits both of us for very different reasons. And I think that having that perspective in the book, that back and forth, I hope made the strategies fit a much wider group of people.
I mean, I think it did. I very consciously set out to write this book with, number one, a journalist. And as I always say, Rachel was part of a cult in college. It's called the Yale Daily News.
Yes, it is.
So, but also with somebody who is much younger. Because I think when older women offer career advice, particularly women of my generation, so I always say we had to feel really comfortable with masculinity, because we grew up in rooms of men. And so if we didn't, we wouldn't be there. And so I think a lot of the career advice that women my age traditionally offer is sort of just, it's a disconnect, because a very different and much wider group of women is now in these high-powered roles. So Rachel was perfect. Also, I chose the best writer I could get.
Well, you know, again, Hillary Clinton talks about the sisterhood of the traveling pantsuits. And I was just at a meeting where a woman stood up and talked about the first time that a woman wore pants on Capitol Hill in the House, right? When the women first started getting elected, they all wore dresses. So part of it was that we needed to be seen like men. I do think when I started teaching at Harvard Law School, all the women, so we're both law professors, I was originally, and Joan is still a law professor, all the women law professors at Harvard Law School never wore dresses, right? I mean, if you wore dresses and heels, you were taken as a secretary. So if you wanted to be taken seriously as a professor, you couldn't look traditionally feminine. And I like dresses, you can see that, and mm-hmm. I like heels. And so I remembered dressing. And really being, then people thought it was a political statement, that you must be a conservative, because the gender signaling, I think this generation is freer to choose. You can dress much more how you want. So let's talk about, I'm not going to ask you about this, but let's talk about the maternal wall.
Well, you know, what's been going through my mind as we sit here is the first article I wrote on any of this is called Deconstructing Gender. And I actually was finishing it just about the time that Rachel was being born, a few years after. Actually, it was published in 1989. You were born in 86. Nikki was being born. So here's the story. When I was finishing the footnotes to Unbending Gender one Saturday at the office, I remember getting a phone call and a sweet little girl saying, "Mommy, come home." The maternal wall is both inside us and outside us. A lot of people have written, and I and Anne Marie have written about how it's inside us. And Rachel found a wonderful epigram for one of the maternal wall chapters. She said, you know, there's no way to be a perfect mother and a million ways to be a good one. I think the sure way not to be a very good mother is to insist on being a perfect one. But quite apart from the fact that the maternal wall is something we internalize, it's also, in case we don't get the message, it's something that's out there. If you give one study is worth saying in detail. If you give people identical resumes, one but not the other, a mother, the mother is 79% less likely to be hired, half as likely to be promoted, and offered an average of $11,000 less in salary. This is an order of magnitude larger than glass ceiling bias. And so we give people very concrete strategies. When you return from maternity leave, you should ask for a meeting with your boss and say, I'm really excited to be back. I really want to hit the ground running. These are my career goals for the next year. And let's talk about how we can work together to achieve them. Because you are overcoming that very strong assumption that you're no longer competent or committed. One other strategy that I think is really important, at the Center for Work-Life Law, we're sort of a hub for all of this. And we hear so many times of people who say, you know, my supervisor or my colleague said to me, I don't know how you can work so hard. My wife could never leave the kids like that. Oh, yeah. And so the strategy for that is what we call Tolstoy was wrong. Happy families aren't all alike. That's perfect for your family, but this is what's right for mine. We spent a lot of time coming up with retorts, some of them pretty sassy. In throughout the book, Rachel has, what are they called? Sharp comebacks for
rough moments.
For rough moments. Smooth comebacks. Yes. So we spent a lot of time coming back with smooth comebacks, both that are very low risk, all the way up to sort of true moxie.
And I actually want to add on to that, because I was obviously the sweet little girl voice saying, Mommy, come home. Growing up Joan's daughter, I obviously thought a lot about work-family conflict. And when I was a kid, my takeaway was that there was a terrible irony in her work and in the fact that her work meant that she had to work late sometimes, and she had to travel, and she had to have visiting professorships. And there was tension between us, I think, when I was younger. And so in writing the maternal wall chapter, it was really important to me to try to get the message across that there is going to be tension. And that's going to be a part of the experience. And it doesn't mean you're doing anything wrong as a mother. And I am so incredibly grateful to be Joan's daughter. But that doesn't mean we didn't have fights. And we had them. We had them a lot. And so it's very important to me to be able to participate in her work. And also, I really want people to know that, you know, you're going to have work-family tension, and that doesn't mean that you're not being the best mother you can be.
Oh. I would add to that, because my own mother is a fabulous artist. I mean, she's a very, very talented artist, and she really grew as an artist as her three children went to college and encouraged her. And we're her biggest fans, but she wasn't working outside the home when for the first 20 years of my life. And I knew she would have been happier had she had a professional identity as well as a personal identity, which meant as a mother, I have never doubted that I'm a better mother because I work. And I have never, you know, my sons will tell you that from an early age, you know, when they'd pull the guilt trip, I would just be like, you know, you're not guilting me. I'm a better mother because I do what I do. I would be unhappy, and I would be a worse mother, and I have no doubt about it. And the one time I actually stayed home for a year, they had no doubt about it either. I mean, we were on sabbatical, and, you know, after a year, they were like, goodbye, Mom, you know. I think you're right. It's different families have different ways, but also different, you know, this is a highly personal thing in terms of, are you somebody who likes to do one thing all at once and really pour yourself into it, and maybe you want to be home more and really be a mom full time and then be more of pouring yourself into your career? Are you somebody who likes to do multiple things at once? Are you, you know, it seems to me there is no one recipe. Absolutely. One thing you said, Joan, before we go on to the tug of war, talk a little bit about the social psychology, because at the beginning of the book, you have a very powerful statement where you say, you know, I found an entire academic discipline that allows us to get past just talking about stereotypes and anecdotes. So maybe you can talk a little bit about that.
This book really rests on 35 years of experimental social psychology. Some of this is the implicit association test, which people might have heard about. A lot of these are the matched resume studies. I just mentioned one. And all of this takes place either online or it takes place in social psychology labs at universities. And this is one of the first times, actually the only time I'm aware of, that someone has taken all of that literature, boiled it down, and asked women who are actually at work, hey, any of this sound familiar? The striking thing is that 96% of the women I talked to said yes. One woman said every syllable. One woman said, you just described my life. And so there has been some question about whether these experimental studies actually describe what goes on at work. But one of the things this book shows is that they do. And another element that's been very little discussed is that women of color reported more of every single type of gender bias than the white women did. A lot of variation among the women of color in terms of the which of the types of bias they experienced more and which less. But by and large, they experienced more of the gender bias.
I want to come back to that in a minute to talk about also that experience, which you call double jeopardy in that chapter. But just to say, I mean, the power of these experiments is that they uncover, you know, the unconscious biases. Very few of us live in worlds where there's overt sexism of the kind that there used to be, where anybody's going to say to you, no, you know, I don't think a woman can do the same job as a man. I mean, some may think it, but I think many don't think it. But it's that deeper layer, right? It's that layer that says, a mother, she doesn't need to earn as much as a man, or she won't be as committed. Those aren't conscious, but they come out when in these experiments. But let's talk about the final obstacle, the tug of war among women. I'll let Rachel talk about that a little bit, because as a younger woman, I talk to many younger women who say to me, my male bosses are actually better to work for than my female bosses, which I always find very jarring, and it's obviously not universal, but I've heard it, I've given scores of speeches, and that's a very frequent question. So maybe you can talk about this a little.
So the tug of war is what happens when gender bias against women turns into conflict among women. And I think that the things we've talked about in the last couple of minutes, a lot of them have been very, very personal. We've talked about decisions related to childcare and child rearing. We've talked about sort of whether you are more comfortable being feminine in the office or more comfortable being masculine in the office, and the backlash from both of those. And so I think that gender wars happens when those very personal decisions come under criticism from other women. And I think that the really important takeaway with gender bias is that this tension happens, with regards to gender wars, is that this tension happens because of the underlying gender biases, these judgments about what the right way to be a woman. These judgments really lead women to be very sensitive about their own choices. And it can lead to major conflicts in the workplace and in the professional sphere when people make different choices.
You wanna?
Yeah, I mean, I do think that the instinct of feminists up to now has been to deny this and say, you know, you're talking about the queen bee and that's just stereotyping women.
Right.
I do think the queen bee is stereotyping women. Actually, this is not a problem of the personality problem of an individual woman. What the studies show is that women who have experienced discrimination early in their careers tend to distance themselves from other women. And why wouldn't they? That's just politically savvy. Think of Marissa Myers. I'm not a girl at Google. I'm a geek at Google. She's identifying with the in-group. She's not identifying with the out-group. So I think it's time to stop denying that this is happening, because like Anne Marie, young women to say this to us all the time, and to say it is happening, but it's a symptom of gender bias in the environment. And you know, two bits of advice, because this is basically a book about, not about how to depressingly wallow in these things.
I'm going to get to the solutions. Don't worry.
I think a bit of advice to women my age is to recognize that the younger women are simply different from what we are like. They are different, and that success, that we've been able to create that room for them. And for younger women, I think it's really important for you young ladies to recognize that one of the reasons that we are not helping you as senior women as much as you wish we were is that we're navigating all four of these patterns of gender bias ourselves, and we don't have often as much power as you assume that we do.
I would agree with that. The other thing I would add, I often start out when I talk to a group of women by saying, you know, but for the women 10 years ahead of me, I would have a radically different life. We owe them an unbelievable debt, and your generation doesn't really understand that because we've succeeded. I mean, we've succeeded so that Mad Men looks like some ancient history as opposed to something that many of us can actually remember. And so I think it's very important to just to honor that enormous sacrifice and struggle. And I always say I came out of school in 1980, and by 1990, when I was looking for a law teaching job, law schools were looking for qualified women. But in 1980, you know, not. And so
that was the year I entered law teaching.
So the difference between us then is that exact 10 years where because of your success. And you're also right that to be a woman, to do women's studies in law teaching was, I mean, that was not the, that was the out group, right?
When I went to Harvard Law School, there was not a single woman on the faculty. None. Not one. And I went into the dean as part of the Women's Law Association. I said, it's come to my attention. There's not a single woman on the faculty. And he said, well, you know, we've really tried hard. There are just none qualified. And I said, not one in the whole world? And he said, no.
That would include Ruth Ginsburg, right? I mean, there were Ruth Ginsburg, who left Harvard and went to Columbia because of her husband, and then Harvard wouldn't give her a degree because she hadn't completed Harvard Law School. They claim her now. so let's turn to the solutions, right? Those are the four, the big barriers, and I love this book in part because it's easy to remember them, and it's easy to sort of think to yourself, yep, 1, 2, 3, 4. But you're right, so much of the power of the book is the solution. So talk about some of your favorite. You can't go through them all, but some of the, we've talked about the posse, but talk about some of your favorites.
Well, let's just start with prove it again. The first thing I think for young women is not to do this to yourself. So one of the things that we often hear is that if a promotion requires, for example, 9 things, the guys will go for it at 6,
yeah,
and the women will wait until they have 10. Why? We feel like we're a little bit more at risk, and you know what?
We are.
But the solution is not to wait till you have 10, because the guys will do it at 9. So I think it's very important to put yourself out there and lean in,
yeah,
as some of our friends say.
Lean in.
If you see this being done, if you see a woman with double standards being applied, for example, in a meeting, you can just very mildly say, you know, I think we finally recognize what we're really looking for in a candidate. So let's go back to the top of the pile and make sure we found all of the relevant candidates. So the solutions, I think, for many people are the most useful are these sort of low-risk solutions. But one of the things that Rachel and I did, and she'll talk maybe more about it, is I assembled a group of very wise women to help us write the book, because I'm not the most politically savvy person I know, not by a long shot. So there's a pattern Rachel calls the stolen idea, where a woman says something and it's overlooked, a man says something and he's Albert Einstein. One woman's reaction, she said, well, what I just say is, well, is there an echo in here? are some of your favorites?
Just to go to sort of talk a little bit more about the stolen idea, that's one pattern that really I think rang true to a lot of people. And we in a meeting of the wise women, we just asked the room, what would you say if you were in that situation, or what have you said when you've been in that situation, because it's such a common experience to have. And the answers really, really ranged from sort of saying like, thank you, Joe, I'm glad you picked up on that idea, to saying, sorry, you must have been looking at your BlackBerry when I mentioned that. This was a couple years ago. It probably would have been iPhone now.
So that's such a great one. We've all been through it. When it was pointed out to me, it was called the butterfly syndrome, that a woman would say something and it would lie there on the table like a pupa, and the man would say something and it would, you know, fly. And so the things that I've seen are often when there are multiple women in the room, you pick up on it for the other woman. So,
yes,
you know, if you say something, then I always come in, and this happened a lot at the State Department, and every woman knew what was going on. The other woman says, yes, you know, as Rachel just said, after the guys made the point, so that you come in and make clear to the room, which is a little easier than the woman herself,
yes,
having to say that. The other thing I've done is to pull aside younger men and say to them, this is what just happened. And I say, you know, you're going to work with a lot of talented women. You need to know. You need to recognize this. This is what just happened. You said this, or another guy said this, and it was ignored. The woman said this, then you said it, and suddenly it took off. And this is an area, when I said this is a book that women who work read and men who work with women, this is exactly a place where guys, once they're sensitized to it, can be extremely helpful. And many of our husbands, I think, I know my husband is very aware of it, not always when he does it, but when other, but so I think that that is a really great example of how you can make that difference. Any others?
One other thing that I think is really important, which I've kind of gotten an F minus on, I have to say, in my life, but is how to negotiate for a raise, which is another big issue for women. One of the things, and Rachel's much more moderate on this, but I will just rant, that drives me a little nuts is the whole women don't ask conversation, because it is true that women don't ask. It's also true that if they do ask, people are less likely to want to work with them and they're less likely to be hired. Oh, forgot to tell you about that one. So all of those organizations that are teaching women to ask are basically teaching, you know, feeding them into the maw of it's not going to work. And because when you ask, you have to walk that tightrope. Asking and negotiating for a raise is something that's seen as masculine. So what the studies show, and this is also what we found, is that you have to do gender judo. You ask for in the name of your group. You ask, but say, I'm worried about how X might feel about this because blah, so what a good woman, always attuned to the comfort level of others. But we are very concrete in the book about how you ask for a raise. First of all, the next time a recruiter calls you, even if you're happy at your job, don't hang up. She's your new best friend because she can tell you how much you're worth, and you need to get those, you need to get the facts down as part of your salary negotiation, and that's a very good resource to get to go in. Forewarned is forearmed, because you can't, as a woman, go in and say, "I'm the most brilliant thing since sliced bread," because then your name begins with a B. So you need to start with the facts.
Absolutely. You have a slightly different view on this.
I do agree. I think that it's good advice, and I think that this shows the difference between where Joan and I lie on the tightrope. I think it's important for me to hear that I need to ask because my instinct is going to be not to do it in the first place. And so I need that extra encouragement to go into the office, but I do think that it's very important to go in and go prepared. So you have to go knowing what your achievements are. You have to go making an argument for why you deserve this raise. So it's time, I've been here for X amount of time, other people in my position make this amount of money, these are my accomplishments, this is how much money I've earned for the firm. Going there with objective facts. And I also think that the being willing to leave is often a huge, huge plus in that. So just know that if you go in there with that, I have another offer, or I've been looking, or I've been in contact with recruiters, that can be a huge help in sort of getting your foot in the door on a raise or a promotion.
I mean, I have to say, one of the best things about Lean In is I have already seen three people ask and have said, I know I have to do this, right? I know I have to do it. And it's great. But you're right. How to do it is very important. I have another friend, Kate Clark, who wrote a book called Dare to Ask that also talks about the strategies, because doing it cold can backfire, but I love that. I mean, I love seeing the immediate impact of Lean In, where women now feel like, yep, this is what I got to do. The other thing, there are two other things I would say is, one is men are often great coaches here, right? And I've talked to a lot of guys recently who really take pride in sort of say, and actually Sheryl Sandberg talks about that, and I wrote a story on the Lean In website where I talk about my husband, the first leadership job I ever took, I was going to suggest somebody else, and my husband said, "Well, why not you?" And I was like, "Well," and he's like, "No, come on, you're better than so you can use the men in your life, whether they're your brothers or your fathers or your spouses or whatever, I think is very helpful. And the last thing I've always found to be helpful is to think of myself as the breadwinner, right? And my husband earns a good living, but I am the primary breadwinner. And in negotiating, I would often say, I'm the primary breadwinner for my family. It's important, that I need to make sure that I'm doing what I need to do. And it helps me thinking that way, right? That I'm not asking for more money for me. I'm supporting, my family. So I think that's another way that you can kind of edge into that space. It's 1 o'clock. I'm sure you have no questions at all. There is a microphone. Liza, is there? I'm not sure. I think there's a microphone that will come around. But raise your hand, and here comes Liana. Great. Raise your hand and introduce yourself right there.
I should probably stand up. Hi. Is it on?
Yeah.
Hello.
Hi. Anne Marie Widener, Georgetown University. I'm wondering about class. And you mentioned at the beginning you interviewed successful women. So would any of your strategies, would you say anything different if you were speaking to a group of working class women and men, or even lower than that? Yeah. Thank you.
This book is really written in the vein of business advice literature. And so, as you know, Anne-Marie, my last book was about class. I haven't studied what the gender dynamics are at work in different class locations. And so I would say this, I don't know how much of this carries over. I do know that it varies from industry to industry. The interviews of the scientists were very different in tone than the interviews of the women in law and business. And I think part of that was because they were women of color. And part of it was because they were women in science.
Well, and of course, Liza Mundy's book, The Richer Sex, talks about how in the middle class and middle income, women are out earning men increasingly. And so, of course, that puts. And I remember talking to Michelle Martin about that experience, where she said a lot of women don't want to challenge the masculine authority of their spouses, so they kind of put the money on the table, but without, as sort of helping out. In other words, not recognizing. So there's a whole different set of, yeah, of gender dynamics. Other questions? Here on the side, and then there on the front. Yeah.
I have a question. What would you
just
say?
Introduce yourself, please.
Hi, I'm Allison Crawford, and I work at AAAS Science Magazine.
Excellent.
And I was wondering, what would you say for younger women, or how would you, tell us to approach some of us that have read Lean In and come in and listen to you talk and are a bit more aware of some of the gender biases, and I wouldn't want to say aggressive isn't the right word, but more eager to approach the latter. And we work for very nice women of an older generation, but may or may not be as aggressive, or they've been content in their position and don't really ask for the pay raises or the any other kind of promotions, I guess.
So I see this as sort of a tug of war issue among women, where you're saying there's an older generation who tends to be happier to play a more feminine role, and you as a younger generation are sort of, let's go for it. That's a recipe for sometimes conflict among the women. And how do you diffuse that? Any ideas?
I have some, but I think yours are probably better.
I think it's important to look around you and maybe past your sort of immediate work environment to see what other opportunities are out there. I think it's important to recognize that you maybe have different aspirations than the women you work with, and do what you need to do with that information, but don't try to, you can't demand that they sort of change anything about their own lives in order to help you.
One thing, and I think Anne-Marie said this before, and it's really important, is particularly if you're going to be in conflict with a woman of an older generation, it's really helpful to start by saying, I really appreciate the fact that I'm only here because of you. Very simple, just thank you.
Yeah. It goes a long way. Yes, here in the front.
Okay. Does this work now?
Yes.
Yes. So I'm going to really enjoy.
Just introduce yourself.
Okay,
please.
I'm going to enjoy introducing myself. I'm Liana Zizulin. I work in international development, and the reason I'm going to enjoy it is because I'm going to mention that I'm Joan's law school roommate. So I had to come hear her.
And also my godmother.
There's a picture of Liana and I both looking with our back to back, looking very rotund.
Yes. And I'm very happy to have been to have been able to be here. I should have been in South Sudan, but as you may have noticed, people got evacuated. And the point that I wanted to raise actually occurred because of that. I'm back unexpectedly and have talked to a headhunter or two here or there. And somebody said, yes, but you've worked only part-time. And I'm like, what? My youngest child is 25. I worked part-time exactly from 1988 to 1995, the last century. And I thought, I've got to purge my resume. Somehow that should not be coming up. But and this came up from a female recruiter who pointed out that she was older than I was. So I'm just wondering, how do you guys want to comment on part-time? And Joan, you and I have discussed this, the ins and outs of that many times over the years.
Yeah. So I just want to say, I remember one of the women that we spoke with said that she had gone part-time for a while at her job, and she needed it. She needed to do it for personal reasons, but she called it a career bender. She said it was just a huge, it was very hard to get out from under it, and she felt like she was walking around with a PT on her back. And I think that that's a common experience. What this woman ultimately did was go to another firm, find another job, but that doesn't sound like it's helping you here.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, it's what, we actually did a series of studies on it. I call it the flexibility stigma.
Yes.
And the flexibility stigma is, it's going part-time is one of the triggers for maternal wall bias. Remember that unbelievably strong bias? For men, it's actually a femininity bias. Even asking for parental leave triggers strong organizational sanctions because the men are seen as too feminine. Liana, I would just advise you to take it off your resume. Society can't handle it. Strong.
But there are two, so I've been thinking about this a lot also, and the your piece on flexibility stigma is great. So now when I give a talk, I tell people, don't start by asking for the flexibility policies. Most places have flexibility policies of some kind or other. Start by talking about how do we combat flexibility stigma. Right? Nobody likes stigma. Right? That's the place to start, is to say, you know, how are we going to fight the fact that if anybody, woman or man, takes advantage of these flexibility policies, they are discriminated against. And that's a better place to start the conversation. And you start by accepting that. So that's one thing that I think we have to take this on. We really absolutely have to take this on. We have to take it on for men as well as for women, because, you know, if we want men to be able to take the leave that we need them to take, then they can't be discriminated against. But the other thing that's helping this, that I've seen a lot of, is increasingly sort of portfolio careers. Where, you know, I'm part-time a writer, I'm part-time a teacher, I'm part-time a speaker, I'm part-time a manager. And increasingly people, when I advise younger women, I say, you know, look at who you want to be and look at the set of skills that they have and think about how to acquire those skills at different points of your life. So even if you are, you know, working in the community, you can learn how to fundraise, you know, you can learn how to be a speaker. And I'm increasingly seeing guys who are not any one thing, right? That they are, and part of it's startup culture, part of it is and tech culture more broadly, so that part-time looks less like, well, I was in on the career ladder and I wasn't the ideal worker, to borrow John's term, and rather, you know, I have a flexible career and a portfolio of skills. Again, that does not help your resume, but I think it's... No, it's a great example.
As an example of how people bring this up, even though it's very old.
Yes. Yep. There in the back, we've got, I'm going to go on the right in the back first, just because I've been playing to the left. Whoops, my right. Sorry. Over there. Yep. And then I'll come back to you, I promise.
Hello, I'm a real usury CISC, and I'm a government attorney. I'd like to ask, was there any difference for the women of color when you talked about the butterfly syndrome? Because, you know, as an activist who had to really push, I'm of a different generation than some of you in the room, it really seems like it takes a whole lot of time to get everybody really liking me before I can do something. And that's annoying. It is annoying. You know, like to act as if I have to go, oh, well, thanks, Bob. You know, that is really tiresome. And are other people tired? And is there anything we can do to push this along?
That's great.
You know, it's funny, and I'd love to hear from Rachel. You sound, ma'am, as if you're a lot more like me. There's two ways to look at this. One is, it would be a better world if men had to do this kind of emotion work too. And the other is, this is tiresome. Why do I have to do this when I have this goal? That is the doing the emotion work in order to have what your message accepted is exactly what I call gender judo. The fascinating thing is that the studies, there are very few studies that look at both race and gender. My friend Robert Livingston has done most of them. And one of the things that Robert found is that in the 70s, there was a hypothesis that women of color were in double jeopardy, race as well as gender. And it's a hypothesis, so I was trying to figure out whether it was true. The women of color really differ from group to group, but black women specifically, no matter how high up they were, felt they could not make one single mistake. And there was one amazing story of a lawyer at one of the high up at one of the largest companies in the country, who, when she showed up all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, proud of her new job, was asked her LSAT scores. Never heard that happening to a white woman. But the other study that Robert found, and I found this as well, though clearly it's not always true from your comments, is that African-American women are allowed to behave in more dominant ways than white women before they encounter pushback. Now, it sounds like it didn't happen to you, but Robert found it in the lab, and I also found it in my interviews. Of course, at a certain point, you're an angry black woman, and we know what that begins with, right?
Do you want to add anything?
Nope. I just want to talk about your point that this is exhausting. That's something I'm at the very beginning of my career, and sometimes when I look at the expectations of women, really especially starting out, my reaction is like, this seems exhausting. I don't even know why people try. And I think that's a danger of this conversation. And what the book does, and what Works for Women at Work does, is really give concrete strategies to deal with individual instances, so it doesn't seem quite so overwhelming. I also think it's important to recognize that it's not your fault. The fact that you have such a hard time getting people to like you is not your fault. It's because of these stereotypes and these biases. And I find that really comforting to realize that if I'm having these particular problems, it's not because I'm doing something wrong. And there are things that I can do right to change them or make them better. But a lot of these problems that we face just aren't our fault. And I think that's important to keep in mind.
That's great.
Yes, on the left then. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Alicia Shepherd. I'm a journalist and I'm former NPR ombudsman. And I've done studies about the lack of women on op-ed pages, the lack of women on panels, particularly on the Sunday morning shows, the lack of women as sources. And, you know, sometimes it's not a matter of not reaching out to the women. It's the women saying, oh, no, ask someone else. My boss would be better at this. And so I'm wondering, where does that come from? I mean, are we talking about kindergarten, that that women think they don't have anything to say, or that somebody else could say it better? Or I'm sure it's not the women in this room, but there are...
So you're asking, why do the women themselves take themselves out of the running?
Yeah.
I mean, I think there's a couple things that might be relevant. Obviously, I don't know these women, and I haven't done this study. But if a woman says, my boss would do it better, what my intuition is that her boss would be all ticked off if she got invited, and he didn't. That's called gender bias. That's called the tightrope, right? That part of women's job description is to make the men around her not feel threatened.
Right.
That is not part of men's job description in anything like the same proportion. Another thing I would wonder is if a woman is on those talk shows where there's so few women, are people is she going to be attacked for being butchy, for having bad lipstick color, for wearing the wrong clothes? Are people going to listen to her? Or is she going to have to scream to be heard, in which course, guess what her name begins with? I just think it's really important when women are taking themselves out of these positions to retain a focus on the fact that going on those talk shows in this environment when there's so few women is different for women, because what works for women at work is really different often than what works for men.
I'd also just like to add that one of the classic studies on the double standard for men and women and on the sort of associations with masculinity and femininity found that women are stereotyped as being communal, and they're expected to be communal. And that's a great example of community-oriented behavior. Mm-hmm. I can't do that, but here's someone else who can. And so I think at some level, that's how women are trained to act. And it takes a lot of consciousness, and it takes a lot of really paying attention to the dynamics around you to be able to overcome that. And that's one of the reasons why we hope people will read this book and recognize that these stereotypes exist. Because if you get the message that you're supposed to be communal, then often you will be.
I just add one more thing also, because I've thought about this a lot. And in foreign policy, it's just a joke. I mean, there's so few of us who are, and those of us who do it, of course, are asked over and over and over, and we don't have time. Then there are plenty of other really talented women out there. But some part of it goes back to what Joan said about the prove it again and our own standards, right? So many younger women, understandably, are like, ooh, I'm not sure if I can do that. Men are socialized when they feel insecure to puff themselves up and put themselves out there, right? I mean, it's like nature. They get all puffed up, and even though they're insecure, that's their reaction. Women often have exactly the opposite reaction, which, again, these are survival strategies in lots of ways, but the fear's legitimate. It's to how you react to the fear, and again, that's where Lean In, I think, can be very helpful, where it says, you know, Sheryl Sandberg says, even when I'm really scared inside, I know, you know, to raise my hand and sit at the table. And so it's re-socialization, I think, in many ways, of what you do when you're insecure.
The other thing I would just mention, just picking up on that theme, is Amy Cuddy's work. And she talks about body language, which we also talk about in the book. Look at how the three of us are sitting. We're sitting all in very feminine ways. You know, actually, even primate studies show that people that primates who take up little room are signaling deference to higher status primates. And so I would say all of us who aren't wearing skirts, you know, Don Draper.
Right. They've done all this work that shows if you go like this, right, you're more likely to get an interview if you do this power poses.
And that just shows how we're all on the tightrope, you know?
Okay. Who would like to ask the next question? There on the left. Right there, and then I'll come up to you in the front here.
Hi, Tricia Daniels, Managing Director at Alvarez and Marsala, Forensic Accountant, CPA, and I was prior partner at the Big Four, so I've dealt with these issues a lot. Question regarding the maternal, I forget what you called it, wall. Thank you. As you, so my children are now grown. I have, my youngest is a senior in college, and my other son is out of school and working. Does that go away?
This
I'm
is
hoping,
a huge question.
I'm hoping the answer is yes.
does the bias against you at work? You know, one of the savviest women I interviewed said, you know, when my kids were young, she said, I never let on that I had them. Now, I don't recommend that. That's, you know, that is a woman whose response is very deeply shaped by very strong bias, right? And I don't know that women have to do that anymore, although actually that's what I did, by and large. But this same woman said, you know, when they're older, I make sure I bring them around. Because when they're older, what she was doing is walking that tightrope. She was signaling, I am extraordinarily successful at everything. So when they're older, trot them around. Now, you know, should women have to do this? I have to say that when Rachel was a toddler, I had my professional picture taken with Rachel, so I didn't completely hide. But then this is kind of my issue. So, should women have to do this? No, this is ridiculous, right? Just because you're helping to raise the next generation does not mean that you're less powerful contributor in professional roles. That is absolutely nonsense. So, and I would, you know, if you don't want to do it, absolutely don't do it. But that is what works for women at work.
I would just add, though, that it doesn't sound like you've taken time out, but I think age discrimination is an enormous part of this that we're not facing, that many women who do work differently or take part-time or don't work outside the home when their kids are there, then when they want to get back in and they've got 20, 30 years ahead of them and lots of credentials, are not getting considered. I mean, in our discipline in academia, there's no reason you can't get tenure at 50. You're writing books, you're going to write books till you're 80, and yet you're not even looked at, right? So the issue to me often is not, are you being discriminated against because you're a mother, but are you being discriminated against because you're now older because you were a mother? There on the side, and then I'll come to the front. No, turn around, Leanna, right there, and then, I'm sorry, I've discriminated, but.
Older and Wendy Kahn, I'm a labor union lawyer and plaintiff's employment lawyer. The first question, I think, was about class, and Joan indicated, you know, that this wasn't, your book obviously is not focused on this. It's terrific. I'm just wondering if you're aware if there is any research on the question of obstacles and solutions for people who are not professional women, highly successful or hopefully highly successful. And my next question, whether it's your research or somebody else's, is with regard to the younger people who are, you know, hopefully moving into successful professional roles, is there any kind of consciousness in that journey about their interactions with people who are not professionals that they meet in their own workforce or otherwise? I'm just curious if there's, you know, any consciousness particularly of that, and you know where this comes from.
With respect to the first, one of the focuses of the Center for Work-Life Law now is on pregnancy accommodation for blue-collar women. What happens to blue-collar women, and the center has always worked across class, is my sense is that employers actually didn't want to hire them in these jobs in the first place. So they wait until they become pregnant and then deny them very simple accommodations. I'll just give two cases, one of them gross. The first is that a woman was getting persistent urinary tract infections incident to pregnancy, and so her doctor ordered her to carry a water bottle. A certain large company fired her rather than give her the right to carry a water bottle. The second was that a woman was having severe nausea, and so she asked for a workstation closer to the bathrooms, and the employer said, no, but I'll give you a larger wastebasket. One of the center has an article coming out in, what is it called, Yale? One of the Yale journals, Yale Law and Policy Review, in which we argue that women are currently entitled to a very broad range of pregnancy accommodations under the Americans with Disabilities Act, not because pregnancy is a disability, but because a lot of the problems that women have during pregnancy qualify under the ADA. Just one more example, and then I'll hand it over to Rachel. Many pregnant women get carpal tunnel. So it simply cannot be that if you get carpal tunnel for any reason in the world other than pregnancy, you're covered under the ADA, but not if your carpal tunnel stems from pregnancy. And we're very much hoping that the EEOC will issue guidance based on that theory.
Oh, fascinating. Do you want to add?
So in terms of the generational question, I think one thing that's happening that has never happened before, and we'll see how it ends up playing out, is that gender bias and the types of gender bias women face are becoming very split along class lines. And I think Liza has done work on how the middle class women, with the rise of the service economy, are developing much more economic pull. Sort of wealthier upper class women are still facing the issues that we talk about in this book. And that's not to say that middle class women aren't either, but the relationship between men and women, I think, has split along class lines in ways that the effects of that remain to be seen. One sort of side effect of, I don't know if it's right to say side effect, but one effect of women were moving into the workplace is that a lot more care work is outsourced. And that's another thing that there's just starting to be research on how that plays out along class lines and how that affects the economy and also relationships among women. This book obviously doesn't deal directly with those issues, but I think that there's important scholarship being done. And my generation of women is going to have a big part in that.
So the last question's over here in the middle, but let me just say, as the microphone is coming, Allison Wolf has written this book, Double X, that talks exactly about how now it used to be all women's experience was the same in the sense that what defined us were we were mothers, for those of us who were mothers or caregivers just more broadly, and that now as wealthy elite women have a radically different experience than the experience of their caregivers who are typically low income, and that's actually divided the feminist movement in various ways. One of the reasons I like breadwinning and caregiving is caregiving encompasses everybody, right? I mean, caregiving focuses on the caregiver, whether that's a stay-at-home mom or whether that's the person a professional woman has hired to give care for her parents or for her children. But the last question.
Thank you. Monique Reiser, I'm with Child Care Aware of America. I have two questions, both involving children. One is, I'm a mom, I have two boys, and I've often wondered how, I'm a single mother, how we can raise boys to be, I guess, less part of the problem. As I get older, my boys are 15 and 10, and sometimes I'm hoping just by living by example, by going to work every day and taking care of things around the house, that they'll learn, equality will just be part of their experience. But I'm wondering if you had any thoughts about how we influence boys to be part of the solution. And the second one is about childcare and just how the factor that childcare plays in women working and access to quality and affordable childcare.
I have something to say about boys, but go ahead. I have two.
with respect to boys, I think the thing to recognize is that the way that women have shifted their gender roles is that we kept the old and added the new.
Yes.
We can perform femininity really well. I mean, look at us. We're all very different, but we are, we're girls, right? But then we also are very highly accomplished. But we want to make sure you know both of those things. And that's the way it's going to happen for boys as well. So I think of my son, who I will say very little about because I'm not authorized to talk. But what I will tell you is that he's a weightlifter and he makes really good pies. Those are his two, at a certain point, he's gone on, but at a certain point, those are his two signatures. So what he's doing is, unbending gender right there. He's saying, I am as manly as it gets, and that doesn't exclude being feminine. And Brad Pitt's the same,
I use Brad
he
Pitt
has
all the
babies,
time.
From every
bicep.
Arm, right? Yeah, from every bicep, right? And so I think that's what we have to help. I mean, I've thought a lot about gender flux among men, and in fact, that's one of the focuses of the Center for Work-Life Law. And that's why we did research on the flexibility stigma, because that's one of the things that is keeping men locked in. And so, as Ruth Bader Ginsburg said a long time ago, women are locked into a certain role, men are also locked into a role. And I think what we're all trying to say is that everybody would be healthier and happier if we all had just a little more room.
Do you want to add anything? Don't laugh.
I don't, I mean, I have obviously, I've not raised a family. I grew up with a brother who is wonderful. And I just, I think that my parents did a great job of not enforcing any gender role expectations on us, but also letting us do what we were comfortable with. I'm much more feminine than Joan is, and I didn't wear pants until I was in third grade. I never wore pants. And at around that time, Joan actually started wearing skirts a lot too. She started wearing dresses. They're comfortable. Pants are not
she
that comfortable.
She had to tell me to wear pants today to enact.
So I think that allowing your, in terms of just sort of child rearing, allowing your children to both break gender stereotypes and also enact them insofar as they're comfortable with them helps create a message that it's not about sort of what gender you're enacting, it's about what you're comfortable with and what you're interested in.
And I would just say as a final comment, you know, I wasn't at all a perfect mother. And look what I got.
So I'll end on the boy, mother of boys, because I think about this a lot, and my sons are very funny on feminist subjects, as you might imagine. But so there are two things. One, when I was still a professor, I started at the end of my time, every time a young man would come into my office to ask advice, I would talk to him, and then I'd say, you know, have you thought about what you're going to do if you want a family? I would ask exactly the same question that I, of course, always ask women. Why on earth are we asking women that question and not asking men that question? They're the family. So I started just making it routine. Have you thought about how you're going to fit together a career and a family? And I say that because what I have come to believe raising boys is that we're raising girls with more choices than we're raising boys. We're raising girls with the idea that you can be a breadwinner or a caregiver or both or however you want to divide it. We are still raising boys with the idea that your worth is defined by how much you earn and how far you succeed on your career ladder. And so what I tell my sons is, you know, if you want, you should think about how much you want to be at home. Their father is the lead caregiver, so they see that. Do you, you know, one son wants to be an actor. I say, great, I sure hope you marry a woman, you know, who's going to have a steady income. But to get them to think that they have the option of taking time out and being a full-time dad if they want to, and giving them the kinds of choices that we're now giving women, which we used not to. And that's a kind of different gender judo, but I think we're going to have to engage in it. So this is a wonderful book written by two wonderful people. Go out and buy your book and have them sign it, but give them a big round of applause.
Thank you.
It's great. Absolutely great.
It's fun. Thank you.
I want to make sure you get out there.